Hello friends, I am Nisha Sharma. The topic under discussion today is A Critical Appreciation of A Prayer for My Daughter, Part 2. Part 2 because in our earlier video, we made a stanza-wise analysis of the poem. Yeats was born of Protestant Anglo-Irish parents in 1865. He became interested in writing at a young age and wrote some lovely romantic poems corresponding to the end of the romantic 19th century. In 1889, he met the love of his life, who was his muse and inspiration for a number of years, Maud Gonne. But she finally refused to marry him despite repeated proposals. So it was only well into the 20th century that he met and married, at the age of 51, a woman half his age who gave him the baby girl, whose future is the central preoccupation of a prayer. Now the occasion. A Prayer for My Daughter is a poem by William Butler Yeats, written in 1919 and published in 1921, as part of Yeats' collection, Michael Roberts and the Dancer. It is written to Anne, his daughter, with Georgie Heidi Lees, whom Yeats married after his last marriage proposal to Maud Gonne was rejected in 1916. Yeats wrote the poem while staying in a tower at Thor Bellily during the Anglo-Irish War, 2 days after Anne's birth, on February 26, 1919. The poem reflects Yeats' complicated views on Irish nationalism, sexuality, and is considered an important work of modernist poetry. Now, the nature of the poem. Just as the title of the poem indicates, the poem is a prayer-like poem, and it generally tells about the poet's ideas about his daughter, who is sleeping at the same time while the poem is being told. The poem by Yeats portrays how a father, blessed with a daughter, prays for the future happiness and well-being of her. The poet hopes that instead of growing up to be a woman of immense beauty, his daughter should be blessed with attributes of a virtuous and a great soul. She should be well-mannered and full of humility, rather than being strongly opinionated, to avoid any intellectual detestation that could drown her in misery. A Prayer for My Daughter demonstrates concern and anxiety over the future well-being and prospects of his daughter Anne. He wrote the poem in 1919, shortly after her birth and World War II. So the ongoing unsettling feel is visible in the background and the poet's mind. W.B. Yeats, in his 10 stanza poem, questions how best to raise his daughter. Though by 1919, the war was over in Ireland, war was over. In Ireland, it yet turned normal. So he ponders how she will survive the difficult times ahead in the politically turbulent times. The poem not only expresses the helplessness of Yeats as a father, but all fathers who had to work through this situation. He wants to give his daughter a life of beauty and innocence, safety and security. He further wants her to be well-mannered and full of humility, free from intellectual hatred and being strongly opinionated. Finally, he wants her to get married into an aristocratic family, which is rooted in spirituality and traditional values. Now comes the setting of the poem. The poem begins by describing a storm which is howling, and his newborn daughter sleeping half in her cradle and protected somewhat from the storm. The storm, which can in part be read as symbolizing the Irish War of Independence, overshadows the birth of Yeats' daughter and creates the political frame that sets the text into historical context. In stanza 2, the setting for the poem is revealed as being the tower, a setting for many of Yeats' poems, including the poem Book of Poems entitled The Tower. This is Thor Bellili, an ancient Norman tower in Galway, which Yeats had bought in 1917 and where he intended making a home. The poem consists of 10 8-line verses, which divide as to their content into 5 pairs of verses. First and second describes the setting of the scene. Third and fourth, first wish for the girl, let her not be too beautiful. Fifth and sixth, second wish, let her be kind. Seventh and eighth, third wish, let her not be a modern woman. And ninth and tenth, conclusion. Now, the first wish. With half a century's experience of life behind him, the poet hopes firstly that his little girl will not be too beautiful. Too much beauty could distract either the young men around her or herself, because if it became her purpose in life, she could turn self-centered and unkind and finish up being left alone. Yeats recalls from ancient Greece two examples of very beautiful but unhappy women, Helen of Troy and the goddess of love, Aphrodite. There is some craziness that gets into very beautiful women, Yeats has observed, so that all their gifts turn poor. And here is an autobiographical element too, because probably Yeats has in his mind Maud gone. Now the second wish. For his own girl, the poet wishes that she may have kindness of heart rather than beauty. Because whereas a woman's exterior beauty can turn men into complete fools, her inner warmth and charm can make a man lastingly happy. May his girl grow and flourish like a tree hidden away. May her thoughts be as tuneful as the song of a bird, rejoicing everyone around, getting into no arguments or silly pursuits, rooted and thriving in one place like a laurel bush, happy to stay at home. And here, when the poet talks about the external beauty, he is talking about Maud gone. And when he talks about the internal charm, he is talking about Georgie Hyde, who was his wife. Now, the third wish. By way of contrast, the poet's mind turns back to his own harsh experience. He has cultivated mind and sought out a kind of beauty that brought him only to hate the greatest of misfortunes. Whoever nurses no hatred within will be disturbed by no storms from without. Yeats recalls in particular the love of his life, without mentioning her name, who by spurning withdrawal and pushing herself and her opinions on everyone around, trashed her splendid gifts and turned, as they would say today, into an angry old man. And this refers to Maud gone. And concluding the poem, the poet says, let his daughter drive out hate and she will discover that all joy, peace and fear arise only from within herself, and heaven will be with her. Then let all men fret, let all storms raise, let all anger burst upon her, still she will be happy. And when she marries, let her keep all pride and anger out of her home and foster there instead what Yeats call custom and ceremony. Custom is avoidance of unnecessary change, like the rootedness of a tree, permitting it to blossom and grow. Ceremony is all those outward forms of politeness proceeding from inward calm and dignity. In such a home will innocence and beauty flourish. Now we come to the theme of a prayer for my daughter. The theme of the poem is love and anxiety of a father who has been blessed with a daughter. It also presents the poet's hopes for his daughter and his expectation of her becoming a very beautiful woman, blessed with the attributes of a virtuous soul. The setting of the poem is uncertain, for the poem is conceived in the mind of the poet. The speaker is the poet himself talking to his daughter. The poem is conversational and didactic in tone, with varying emotions of gloom, uncertainty, hope, and fear. A Prayer for My Daughter is concerned with surviving the chaos of the modern world, the separation of reason from passion, or the surrender of reason to one's own violence or the anarchy of the external world. Certain things in human nature do not change. It is to such great truths as love and death that poets of all ages are impelled to give a special expression in poems. In A Prayer, Yeats is expressing his care for the future of his baby girl. A Prayer is the poem of a modern man, driven by an ancient parental love to give modern expression to some ancient truths. Now, the structural analysis. The poem is written in a lyric form containing 10 stanzas with 8 lines in each stanza. It follows a regular rhyme scheme, which is AA, BB, CD, DC. The meter of the poem alternates between iambic pentameter and trochaic pentameter, as in, I walked and prayed for this young child and hour, and heard the sea wind scream upon the turf. The poem is rich in literary devices such as symbolism, personification, paradox, sibilance, assonance, alliteration, and onomatopoeia. The line, murderous innocence of the sea, is an example of paradox. Sibilance is found in the word sea wind scream, while scream is also an example of onomatopoeia. The use of personification can be noted in the lines, future years, dancing toward, which implies the transience of life. The poet uses symbols such as sea wind and flooded stream, which denote turbulent forces at work. Alliteration is present in the phrase, be granted beauty. This poem can be seen as a combination of classical as well as modern. On the one hand, to say that chiefest of evil is hate, suggesting that chiefest of goods is love, is the message central to 2000 years of Christian civilization. To say that a woman's place is in the home may be unfashionable today, but it was the most classical common sense until, say, 100 years ago. Yeats has come to recognize that the true happiness of woman, as of those around her, depends on her fulfilling her vocation to live withdrawn, a life rooted in the home, where she can foster innocence and beauty. Such classical wisdom is rejected by modern women who wants to live in public like the men, fighting to be like them, fighting her deep down nature. On the other hand, A Prayer is a product of our own times, precisely because Yeats has had enough experience of modernity, not only to know how unhappy his daughter will be if ever she goes the feminist way, but also to foresee that the whole of civilization is whipping itself into madness. Like so many famous writers of the last several centuries, Yeats does not have all the answers, but nobody can say he has no handle on the problem. No reader today can say that Yeats does not speak to his situation. Now the language. The language of A Prayer is both classical and modern. On the one hand, the rhyme scheme of each 8-line verse is regular. The rhythm of each line is basically iambic, and no sentence is so difficult to read that it cannot, with a little attention, be understood. On the other hand, there are some rough rhymes. There are in each verse 2-4 beat lines to prevent any monotony within the framework. One must pay more than a little attention to catch the full meaning of, for instance, horn of plenty, custom and ceremony. Thus, Yeats uses the words to the full, but in a modern way, without any trace of romanticism or sentimentality, even to express a father's concern for his child. He is a modern poet, yet he does not have all the answers. The gloom arising within him when he thinks of his child growing up in the world, as he knows, it is enough to drive him to pray, but there is no mention of God. Now, some quotes are there in the poem which work as guidance for parents as well as their kids. The poem is concerned with the chaotic modern world. It shows a father consumed with apprehension for his daughter's future in an uncertain political situation. The father is tense about how he can possibly protect his daughter from the raging storm outside because she is very beautiful. Therefore, he prays for her as well as gives advice about how to live successfully on earth. Similarly, modern day fathers can send quotes from this poem to their daughters as a piece of advice for special occasions. Like, in courtesy I would have her chiefly learn. Hearts are not had as a gift, but hearts are earned by those that are not entirely beautiful, yet many that have played the fool for beauty's very self has charm made wise. And many a poor man that has robbed, loved, and thought himself beloved from a glad kindness cannot take his eyes. This poem has been criticized by feminists also. As the poem reflects Yeats' expectations for his young daughter, feminist critiques of the poem have questioned the poet's general approach to women through that text's portrayal of women in society. In Yeats' Ghosts, Brenda Maddox suggests that the poem is designed deliberately to offend women and labels it as offensive. Maddox argues that Yeats, in the poem, condemns his daughter to adhere to 19th century ideas of womanhood, ideals of womanhood, as he focuses on her need for husband and a big house with a private income. Joyce Carol Oates suggests that Yeats used the poem to deprive a daughter of sensuality as he envisions a crushingly conventional view of womanhood, wishing her to become a flourishing hidden tree instead of allowing her the freedom given to male children. This was after Yeats was rejected in Marriage by a Madman. In Oates' opinions, Yeats wishes his daughter to become like a vegetable, immobile, unthinking, and placid. We can conclude the poem, analysis of the poem, in the words of Sarah Belmont. She said, Yeats did such an incredibly job conveying his values. He clearly wished his daughter a good life of tradition, innocence, and ceremony. His tone is advisory light indeed. What a great way to share his wishes, hopes, and dreams. Some people criticize Yeats by saying that he treated his daughter like a rooted tree and not like a human being, but a closer reading of the poem uncovers that he is actually being a very good parent. He is parenting his daughter not to be a condescending or conceited woman when she grows up. In the last stanza, he says that may she have a wonderful bridegroom who shall take her to an aristocratic house where all is accustomed and ceremonious because he liked the aristocratic ways of living in Coolley Park House where Lady Gregory, an Irish writer and promoter of literature, lived. And Yeats was an associate of hers. His own house Thor Bellele was not far from Pule Pa. Thank you.